a missionary came from the Baptist church that my grandfather was very active in and told him that the future of the Baptist church was to address the life of Christ towards the Hispanic community that was growing in Houston. And at that time, there were some descendants from the time of the Texas independence, but the most majority of the people had come because of the Mexican Revolution. So they had migrated to Houston and formed a nice nucleus, of which the Saravia family were one of the big owners of businesses and things. And my father was, so my father as a child started associating with the Mexican community. And that's how he started learning Spanish. And he perfected his skills when he went to Rice, but in truth, his Spanish came from being associating with the people that lived here in Houston from Mexico. There were very few people from other Spanish-speaking countries of the world in that time here in Houston. And so that's why while he was a student at Rice and all, he met Albino Torres, who was a famous orchestra musician, leader, and they formed the Orquesta Típica Mexicana, and my father loved to play the accordion and be the announcer and do the business stuff. He loved announcing. So when he had to leave Rice, he went up, you know, to New York, and that was a different life. But while he was in Houston, he was Mexicano. Punto. He hadn't met my mother or anything. So it was, you know, it was his desire to be amongst his Mexican friends.
What was his full name?
Curtis Leon Farrington.
And his family had been from Texas?
They were. And tell you, there was prejudice inside the family against blacks and against Hispanics, against their Catholics. Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
So it was remarkable that he, you know, he just fell in love with the Mexican community of Houston. And all his best friends were from that community. So the Estrellas, who was a dentist. I mean, I can just go down the line of all the people that were active. Now, when my grandfather, Felipe Santander, came with my mother in 1924 to Houston, he was one of the ones that formed the Club Mexico Bello, Club Recreativo y Cultural Mexico Bello, whose goal was to maintain the Mexican culture amongst the people from Mexico that lived here. So they celebrated Mexican independence in the 5th of May, but not until the 1950s with a police officer, Samaron, who became the president of that group, the leader of the Club Mexico Bello, did we start the quinceañeras celebration for them. But meanwhile, they had elegant parties. And Oscar Holcomb was the mayor of Houston.
Mm-hmm.
And when they would have a party, the people that lived around wherever that party was being held, and it was usually the ladies all dressed in beautiful long gowns, and the men wore tux. Well, the people complained that it was noisy, so they invited Oscar Holcomb to the parties. And he got up at city council and told them it was not noisy, and it was elegant, and they were just jealous.
I love it.
And so that's how the Club Mexico Bello became more acceptable to Houston society as a whole because of Oscar Holcomb's being involved with the Club Mexico Bello. And that was one of the first clubs here because we didn't have LULAC and we didn't have, you know, others. Now, late 60s and early 70s, we had a lot of small clubs that formed and were very active in celebrating in their homes the Mexican cultures. And that was like Familias Unidas and Club Verde Mar. And there was a bunch of them.
And were they groups based of people from Mexico now here? Or were they
descendants
kind of
descendants of those groups? They by that time they were descendants mostly of those groups, not the ones that had come over.
But that was the organizing system,
yes.
kind of
yes.
organic to the community.
Yes.
And dissemination of culture. So
yes, that's what it was. They would do folkloric dancing, and they would do things, you know, that would keep the culture alive.
But no fun. But you weren't getting grants from anyone. It was all
everyone cooperando absolutely.
Con community culture capital.
And most of the things done in the homes. You know, most of the celebrations done in the homes.
Mm.
Sembradores de Amistad came in at that time. That was an organization already formed in Mexico that was benevolent, that, you know, helped other people. And they formed a nice big group here. I mean, this was in the 60s, 70s, and 80s.
Mm.
But most of those groups just, in fact, by the 70s, we see the immigration of more people coming in from South America. And they're mostly professional people, like doctors and lawyers, and because of the turmoil in those countries. And so then we see another groups being formed, such as the what they call the Club 11, which was a group of from Chile, from Colombia, from Mexico.
I had not heard of that. Tell me more about Club 11.
Club 11.
¿Cómo le decían en español?
El Club 11.
El Club 11.
Yeah, and they were 11 couples that would, each one would have a party with a theme, with a cultural theme at their house once a month. You know, each family had one party a year. And then at Christmas time, they would all get together and have a ball or a gala that they didn't raise money, they just paid for the cost from their pockets and invited their friends at the doctor's club. Because many of those members were doctors in the medical center. The medical center was growing and expanding. And a lot of those physicians had gone through their residencies, like my husband, at the medical center. And so that's why they were members of the doctor's club. But I mean, it was for everybody. And we had nights of plays.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they acted in them and everything. I remember, this is funny. One night I was in charge at Dr. Del Castillo's home. We had a sunken living room like this and had a stage area. And we had a striptease. You know, the ladies with long black gowns and long gloves, and the only thing they took off were the gloves. But then two of the men dressed as women and came out, and they were more risque. They wanted the money thrown at them. So that was fun, you know, that was fun to do.
So you were part of the ONCE, you were one of the 11 families?
Yes, Club 11, and we had the Peña 14, which was another group. And they were the same thing, another group of doctors and lawyers and owners of businesses and all.
And Peñas, I'm familiar
with
the whole
yeah.
mecanismo of Peñas.
Yeah, Peñas are groups. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's a group that has a central life.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And most of those people that were in Club 11, Club 11, and the Peña 14 were also became members of Sembradores. Some of them were in LULAC when they were all evolving.
Mm-hmm.
But they were later. They were later here. So, but nevertheless, our Hispanic community was growing in the East End and in Central Houston and towards the North Side, you know, off of Washington in that area, but wasn't spread so much as it is now.
Mm. And for archival purposes, we introduce Elizabeth Choval from KUHF. If you want to...
I wanted to make a side note with the photography is going to be interfering with the audio very frequently, and so maybe we want to have like a part of the interview that where we don't have the photography. I actually didn't even want to jump in, but I just wanted to make that clear. So
well, they'll have the click.
Okay.
It's not my heartbeat. It's the photography. All right.
Tony, continue, please.
And then Pablo Rocha is taking pictures
for
archival purposes. The I love all that too, especially because, well, here's my hidden agenda.
Okay.
Here's my hidden agenda in that I love to hear all of this because you are a progenitor of community cultural capital, investing in the community to create more culture. And I'd like to kind of look at, for the overarching talk, these two bookends. And part of that is that you've been involved with some major organizations, for example, starting the Institute of Hispanic Culture, which then has a trajectory of now being solvent, having its own building, so that thrives. You've also been involved in fighting, I wouldn't call them an arts group though. I wouldn't call them an arts group per se. Now, you've also been fighting for direct art and culture, even like you said with the Peñas and, and those groups, but then you also, you were fighting to start a Latino Cultural Arts Center at what is now the Buffalo Museum.
Absolutely.
And I want to put this all in context. You're still an activist because this week you were forming our nonprofit. And please tell us the name of our nonprofit, soon to be nonprofit.
It's the Latino Cultural Arts Center of Houston. Okay. And it will, it's kind of hard to remember those, the name.
Because it's new.
Because it's new. Yes. My husband, for instance, was the founder of the Institute of Hispanic Culture. He was first elected president. And of course, I was active there. And that was an umbrella group to bring in all of the people from Central, South America, and Mexico that spoke Spanish in one group. But it didn't have the purposes that we have. And our purpose is to have a cultural site, like a museum, and with a stage and everything that will, that we can use for multi-purposes to highlight our Hispanic Latino culture, especially the historical culture beginning with the people who came from Mexico and who we now celebrate because they did very well. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And what I would add too is that we've got Mecca and Talento Bilingue to Houston, but they're struggling constantly for programming.
Absolutely.
They're not state-of-the-art facilities. We love Alice Valdez and Richard Reyes for all the work they've done. However,
that's not what we need.
We need state-of-the-art, fully funded, national-level institutions.
Like the Asians have, like the Czechoslovakians have, like the Italians have. They all have them, but we can't get it.
And to me, that's kind of what I'd like to examine through your historical perspective, because you've been struggling for this.
Oh, gosh.
You know, and we have the talent, we have the people, but something's not quite clicking in. And it's probably bigger than just that issue. You mentioned education earlier.
Yes.
That plays a role.
That does, because without an educated populace that can make a very strong living, then who are our donors?
Mm-hmm.
We have to rely on the benevolence of people who are not Hispanic to give us money to do what we want to do. But on the other hand, all the other organizations have done the same thing. I mean, the Asian Center was from donors from all the foundations and other, and besides just the Asians. So the Czechoslovakian, the same thing. So, and now our black community has fortunately been able to have a museum, and then they have a Buffalo. So they have three big sites already in Houston that are important and very welcomed.
And what I would like to add to that overarching discussion would be also that even with your own life, though, you've mentioned some wonderful moments, and I can tell you've got that resilience.
Yeah,
but you've also talked about navigating some hardcore racism. You've mentioned in your own family. I myself, so I can be the angry activist. I'm the angry activist. This is not a standard interview. This is activism, because you've changed Houston with your work. But I would add, I would say Houston looks like it's a racist place as long as we don't have the museum you've discussed, because some of those barriers our generation wide, and for you to still be having the same struggle for our community. Now, they let us be business people, and to me, that's fascinating.
Yeah.
We can be business people. We can be on that lane.
But limited. Not everybody.
Break that down. Break that down for
well,
us.
Well, I mean, again, it has to do with education. If we don't have a society that educates the children so that they can take those leadership positions with authority, then we're not getting what we need. And also, we need leaders who definitely want to help the community at large and not just enrich their own pocket. That's the temptation. It's human. You know, it's human, and you have to be very strong to think that, you know, that that money that's there is not just for you, it's for everybody in the community to be used to help people move up the ladder of success. And it's not to be just given to people. They have to use their own energy and skills. It's presented to them, and they have to know how to use it. And that's what I feel so bad when I hear of kids leaving the school system in the seventh grade. They get disillusioned, and then they no, I don't want to study anymore. So, and then the next great disillusion is knowing that we're not teaching the children how to learn, because teachers are too busy teaching tests and teaching other things, and they're not teaching the classes like they should be to prepare the students like they should be prepared. So it's a big criticism.
What I want to add too is you've done something about it in many ways, but just one example, the Houston Hispanic Forum,
yes,
which brings tens of thousands of students to the George R. Brown Convention Center. You were one of the progenitors of that group. So I want to make one thing clear. As we chat, especially for history, I love your critiques because you do something about it.
Yes, I can't stand to sit back and see it not done.
Tell us a little bit about the Houston Hispanic Forum and the origins of that.
Well, the Houston Hispanic Forum was formed more to have lectures and information for the general public. But in one of our meetings, when it was in infancy and way back in 83, we had a meeting at my house, and then I told them, you know, nobody ever tells the kids how to prepare for jobs, how to what to do, you know. They just let them just go on by, and if they're fortunate enough to do it, that's great. Why don't we have something like a Career and Education Day, which we can bring the parents of the children from the ages grade 6 and up, even those that are already in college, and give them information about careers so they know what they want to look for if that's what they want to do. And so that's how that Career and Education Day started, because the members supported the idea. And I'm very grateful to all of them, because, I mean, that was a big chance to have to get our first one was at the Thomas, I think it's called Jefferson Convention Center, the old convention center that is now it's still there, the building. That's where we asked the city that we could rent it, and they said yes. And then I said, well, there's a little park right in front of it, just in the middle of the street. We can put a lunch, give them free lunch to the ones that show up. And so the doctors volunteered to bring the ingredients and cook hamburgers in that little thing. So they were the first cooks for us. And so I was grateful to that group.
What year was that?
This was in 83.
And what was the funding like for the group? So, okay, you knew how to start a nonprofit. You knew how to get people together.
Yes.
How'd you find, how much did that cost, and who pitched in?
Well, we got funding from our members for that first one. We all pitched in to cover the costs. And thank goodness that the architects and doctors and engineers of the group were able to, and the businessmen, we had, because we wanted this concept. This was a new concept. It didn't exist in any other group. And I remember going to HISD to ask them to bus the kids in. And they said, oh, you're a bunch of Hispanics. You're never going to do anything. That was the answer I got. Made me more determined. And everybody in our group was more determined because we all worked together. We all worked together for that project, and that's why it was successful. It's not that we were all trying to see, what am I going to get out of it? No. Nobody got anything out of it. And our first speaker was Ben Reyes. He was the councilman at that time. And we had about 2,000 students and their parents the first year, which was really remarkable. So we were there 3 years, and then we got too big for that area, and so we moved. And this was before we had the George R. Brown and all that. That didn't exist. We moved to the Hoffman's Pavilion at the University of Houston. And we were there for about 5 years, and 1 year George Strake, who was Secretary of State of Texas, was our speaker. And when he came in and saw the thousands of students and their parents in the halls there, he said, Dorothy, this place is too small for this. You can't do this here anymore. So then that's when they built the George R. Brown, and that's when we went to the George R. Brown. So we had wonderful speakers during all that time. We had astronauts come in and speak to them at the opening ceremonies, and then later at the breakout rooms were the wonderful things. And what a breakout room is a room dedicated to a topic, like why become an architect? Why go into business? Why own a restaurant? I mean, we had wonderful talks. Mm-hmm. You know, why have a massage parlor? A beauty shop. So we had wonderful speakers, and everybody cooperated, and they're still doing it, thank goodness. Wow. The forum no longer does small forums anymore. I mean, I had forums, helped them with, and I say I because I just got the group together of nurses and all, and we had health symposiums, and that was taken over by the Women's Health Initiatives and other groups. But we had two of those, and of course our big celebration was during the celebration of Texas Independence in 19, whatever it was, what was it, whatever. We were celebrating 150 years of Texas, mm-hmm. Okay? And I was on the committee for the city. And we said, we don't have anything including the Hispanics. You know, we were left out. So I said, well, we're not going to be left out. So we got the Julie Addison building, and we had a one-day symposium of the history of the Hispanics in Houston, Harris County. And we had wonderful events that day, and an art exhibit, and a luncheon, and a dinner. And it was well attended by everybody. And so that I was real fortunate that I was able to gather enough material so that I got a book published. But it was published because of a small grant that I got from the Cullen Foundation, and matched by my husband, or else I wouldn't have gotten it published. Mm-hmm. And it was given out free to the libraries of all the schools in Harris County.
Wow.
So there's no more. I have one that's falling apart, one issue of it.
Which I would love to see at some point, if I may.
Well, I'll try to find it. I think I know where it is. But it does exist in all the libraries. The history of, it's by the Houston Hispanic Forum. Mm-hmm. And it was pictures and... What I did was go into every one of the breakout rooms, the little rooms where we had the talks by different people, and record them on those old-fashioned tapes, you know. And then another lady and I sat and listened to them and put them into the computer.
Oh, wow.
And that's what it is. So I didn't write anything but what was given there, you know. Mm. And I had Dr. Dworkin and another professor from the University of Houston Department of Sociology helped me. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it got published I don't even remember the date, but it was in the 80s, late 80s. Yeah. And as I say, given free. No one sold anything. And that's what the people don't want to do.